concluded there would be a lower standard for probable cause in the context of 5150s as opposed to criminal arrests. There's no support in the law for that proposition. Indeed, the district court cited none. Second, the uncorroborated, disputed word of an estranged, abusive spouse could justify probable cause for.
You have the words exchange and disputed and abusive. But when dealing with police officers, he gets called on the scene and he doesn't know the history. He doesn't know who's abusive, who's estranged. You're loading a lot of terminology in here. A poor officer, and he's in no position to be aware of these concepts. But what he has is he gets called. There's this man that is telling him certain things about the woman, and some of the stuff that he says is corroborated by her. So I think it'd be more helpful to us if you made the argument in sort of less loaded terms. How do you deal with the situation that the officer gets there and this situation is confronted with?
Your Honor, Officer Van Dersen was aware of the history of these two. He indicated in his testimony that he had been aware of at least part of the lengthy call history between these two people prior to making his approach. He also was told by Mrs. LeFay.
So he knew that he was that Mr. LeFay was the strange, abusive husband.
He knew that there had been.
He knew there was a history,
a number of
disagreements between them. He had made a number of calls.
That's right.
He knew that.
Yes. He also knew that there.
What does that tell him about? How does that support his knowledge that he is an abusive, strange husband?
Mrs. LeFay had a very visible bruise on her left forearm that she showed Officer Van Dersen that day and told him that it had been caused by Mr. LeFay. She showed him that. So in
pain, and he's supposed to believe that.
Well,
he takes what she says as gospel truth. I mean, is there something in the prior record? You say, he was aware of the prior incidents. Whether incidents where the husband was arrested for having abused the wife, whether incidents where the husband, the officers are aware that he's been convicted of spousal abuse or anything like that. I mean, he gets there. There's an altercation. One of the people, the one that didn't call the police, shows a bruise and claims it was inflicted by that. How is the officer supposed to sort that out? How is he supposed to make the judgment? Oh, this is the abusive husband, as opposed to this is the wife that tried to sort of hit the husband and fell while trying to. He doesn't know.
Well,
it's like a traffic accident. You're in the car and you think, the other guy hit me, the police come along and they say, well, we don't know who hit whom. All we know is that two cars have collided how does an officer make that decision like that?
Well, I would hold Officer Van Dersen to his own standard in that case, Your Honor. Officer Van Dersen himself said on page 497 of the record that the injury is something that, had he been aware of it, he of course denies being aware of it, it would have required him to investigate further. And that's exactly what POST requires when you go to a 5150 situation where there is an underlying domestic disturbance. It requires you to calm the situation down, to make sure you get the full story, and then, and only then, to make the determination. In this case, Officer Van Dersen made his determination after speaking in an interrupted fashion to Mrs. LeFay for only 3 minutes. For only 3 minutes. He spent 8 minutes on scene, and he himself says the majority of that time he spoke to Mr. LeFay.
Yeah, who said she claims I'm stealing her purse.
Correct. not get qualified immunity because it's been very well established, even in this circuit as far back as, I believe, 1988 in the Meigg case, that the same level of probable cause that exists for a criminal arrest has to exist for a 5151.
Got it. Yeah, but qualified immunity requires a finding on it, requires an additional finding on our part to find civil liability. So even if we thought that there was a Fourth Amendment violation here, we can't find that there's civil liability under 1983 unless we find that the officer should have known exactly what the standards were and that it would have been obvious to an officer that he was not entitled to act in this way. So it's a different standard.
Understood. I think one great example of that is if you look at post-domain 37, which speaks exactly to the situation that occurred here. Officer Van Dersen admits that he was trained in this learning domain and he failed to follow any of its tenets. He was also
an officer who had quite a bit of experience as an EMT and had taken quite a few people in on the 550, 5150.
That's correct, and he had been to many scenes like this. And with respect to another piece of evidence that was ignored in the record, we had a police procedures expert who the district court failed even to acknowledge or mention in its summary judgment opinion, who gave a litany of reasons why the officer's actions were unreasonable. First and foremost,
however, even with such an expert opinion, when I'm looking at whether the officer would have been on notice of violating the law, I'm looking at some case law that would suggest if the officer had known the case law, that he would have been violating. I couldn't find such a case.
Well, I think there's a twofold basis in the case law. Meigg case, which I think is from 88, the Moynihan case, which is more recent, I think 05, and also...
If I don't think those two cases are enough, is there another?
Yes, Your Honor, there are a number of cases which...
Because, frankly, it seems to me that I have a Hahn versus City of Folsom case where a police officer went the other way in similar circumstances. And I couldn't find another case that was exactly like this one, which really would have said to this officer one way or the other. In the Folsom case, it was pretty straightforward that it was a similar situation to what we had here. This is where, in the Folsom case, if you don't remember it, it's where the mother and dad asked the police to assess whether their 20-year-old, 23-year-old son needed to be placed on hold. The officer listened to what they had to say, did what they suggested he should do in confirming it, and then said no. But in that particular case, given those instances, the officer said no, but even if the officer had known about that, wouldn't necessarily have said to him, I'm violating the law if I'd have gone the other way in this particular case, where there are things that she said that she even admits she says that would lead in the other direction, because she says that she told them certain things. She'd not eaten any meals for 3 days. She told them, she didn't tell them certain things, but she told them that. She told them she was being treated for fibromyalgia, general body pain, and depression. She told them, and she admits she's wearing clothes that has an unkempt appearance because she had been packing. There are other things. I mean, I'm trying to look at just the facts she talks about, which the officer now could look at, and then I'm trying to find the case which would suggest he wouldn't have qualified immunity.
Well, Your Honor, 5150 arrests are by definition all arrests indeed are situational, and there are many cases that this court has decided, the Broome versus Bowden case, Arpin, the Mendocino case, Fuller, and Avila, all of which are cited in the briefs. You have to perform a reasonable investigation under the circumstances. And when you come to a situation of domestic discord where someone is upset, they are injured, and you only spend 3 minutes speaking with them, that is not reasonable. peaceful, and that does not entitle you to qualified immunity. Indeed, if we look at Officer Van Dersen's own actions, he says that he did not have a chance to determine whether Mrs. LeFay's apparent signs of dehydration were consistent with dehydration or whether it was just merely fatigue. He says he did not have a chance to investigate.
I thought she said that she hadn't eaten a drug because she thought alcohol was poisoning her.
She never said she had not drunk, and indeed, Officer,
not eaten.
She said she had not eaten meals, and then Officer Van Dersen admits that he never delved further to determine whether she had snacks.
Meals as opposed to snacks.
That's correct. He only specifically asked her if she had had meals, not whether she had eaten anything.
Well, not only that, but she did also say she could not remember consuming liquid.
Well, she says she couldn't remember the last time she consumed liquid, but in that respect, Officer Van Dersen says he didn't feel like he had a chance to delve into that issue. What prevented him? This was not a time-limited investigation. He could have spent as long as he wanted to dealing with these people to make sure he ferreted the truth before he involuntarily committed this crime. Moreover, with respect to the dehydration and malnutrition issues, those are directly contradicted by the medical evidence. Once Mrs. LeFay got medically checked, there was no sign that she was either malnourished nor dehydrated. She was weighed in at 5'6", 160 pounds, and her initial med check shows that she was hydrated. She was described as a well-nourished, hydrated individual.
What does that mean?
Well, it shows that there's a grave doubt as to the reliability of Officer Van Dersen's determination.
But she seems to be a police out there, but they do, they don't. He can't do a test to identify whether she's hydrated. When the husband says she doesn't even drink because she thinks I'm poisoning her, she makes statements that sound confirming to me. I mean, maybe you parse it carefully if you're not a lawyer, and if you conduct cross-examination, you might find that not. But, you know, essentially they confirm what the husband says. He's supposed to conduct a test and check to see whether she's hydrated or not.
Well, Your Honor, I don't believe
what the test make later. How does that cast doubt on his decision at the time before the test was taken, when he doesn't have equipment to take the test?
This was right after she was taken in for a medical evaluation, Your Honor.
Yeah, I understand, but it's afterwards. This is how time works.
Right.
You can't relate to. How does he know? He doesn't know that that's what the test is going to show.
Right.
And he has no ability to conduct the test himself. He doesn't have equipment.
True, but even by his own admission, he did not know at the time. And he needed to know to determine probable cause.
So are you saying he needed to give a test for hydration?
I'm not saying that. I'm saying that, however, he couldn't rely on the husband's words, particularly when he knew, according to the
press. She says, I don't remember the last time I drank. I haven't taken meals. You know, generally, she seems to confirm what the husband says. What does throwing in the fact that later on she is shown to be hydrated, how does that possibly bear on the situation?
Well, it goes to the issue of his credibility, and it also goes to the fact that...
How does it go to the issue of credibility?
If Mrs. LeFay, after being transported to a hospital in an ambulance, where assumedly she did not eat a meal nor drink liquid, and then arrives appearing hydrated and nourished, how did she look any different to Officer Van Dersen?
Well, the question is not whether she, in fact, is. The question is whether he has cause to believe that she's not, that she is not hydrated and that she hasn't been eating. The fact that it turns out later that she's given a test and the test shows the opposite, I just don't see how that bears on it.
Well, what I think does bear on it, Your Honor, is Officer Van Dersen had to do his own investigation. And if you look at the petition, which is on page 221, it says in the fine print, the following facts have been deemed established. And these are what he's representing his investigation showed that justified asserting this 5150 holding. against Mrs. LeFay, but in his handwritten section that appears below, all it is Mr. LeFay's allegations. He did not take any reasonable amount of time to de-escalate the situation and to make his own determination, as opposed to relying on the determination.
I have a tough time with your argument about that, because if an officer comes into a situation and he's got two people fighting, and he's got to take one of them first. He takes one, then he tries to go confirm the allegations in the second. That's why when I looked at this, even taking your facts and taking them exactly as you suggest them, I looked at what did the husband tell the officer, because that's what we've got to really look at, because it's the officer's idea of the probable cause. So then I take your facts and I say, okay, what part of your facts can confirm what the husband said? Confirm. And all I thought that this statement that you're referring to there is what the officer felt was confirmed of what the husband had told him. That's why he thought that was the way it was. He isn't saying the husband thinks it. That's what he thought after visiting with the husband, visiting with the wife, looking at the situation. These were the facts confirmed to him. If he'd have never talked to the wife, that's one thing. But he did.
I disagree in a few important respects, Your Honor. Mr. LeFay said that Mrs. LeFay was delusional. Officer Van Dersen said she was alert, responsive, and indeed he did not conclude she was delusional.
Well, that says that he doesn't take the husband's side. That says he makes an independent determination.
But yet he writes
against what you're talking
about. But yet he writes in the 5150 petition that she was delusional.
I understand what he wrote, but I also understand what he said.
But everyone who is making the decision whether to commit this cruel woman is looking at what he wrote. And he says she's delusional, even though he subjectively concluded that she was not. With respect to Alzheimer's, that's a non-issue. That's a neurological condition. That's not a mental health condition. Thank you.
Okay, we're here for the other side.
Good morning, Your Honors. May it please Court, Erica Damarena on behalf of the City of Fresno, appellees, specifically Officer Daryl Vanderson. My remaining three defendant officers are not subject to this appeal, and therefore summary judgment should be affirmed as to those three. That would be Sergeant Lynn Glein, Detective John Gomez, and Officer Eric Canabaker. With respect to Officer Vanderson, it's undisputed that he had plenty of probable cause to place the 5150 hold on Ms. LeFay. And this decision was, in fact, confirmed at the hospital when she was presented to St. Agnes, where the policy of the hospital is that when the attending physician, as well as a social worker, meet and assess the patient, they could, at that point, release the hold if they so chose. In this particular instance, she was not. She was instead transferred to behavioral health to be evaluated by a psychiatrist. So Officer Vanderson's decision to place a hold was in fact confirmed by the emergency room physician and social worker. There's information in the record that perhaps the social worker may have not spent too much time with her, or perhaps she may have seen her while she was sleeping. However, that was never explored in discovery. The social worker was never identified. The social worker was never deposed. And so that argument is very weak. And the bottom line is the policy of the hospital allowed for the hospital to transfer her to get that psychiatric treatment, which confirms Officer Vanderson's decision to place a hold. The probable cause that he had, the information Officer Vanderson had when he arrived on scene, and again, just like the court noted, based on his extensive experience, he was not only an emergency medical technician, he was also a paramedic for 10 years before becoming a police officer. Based on that experience, the undisputed facts show that he did have information about at least one prior call regarding this couple, and that happened about an hour before he arrived. Two officers from the Fresno Police Department arrived, responded to a call that Mr. LeFay placed as the victim, alleging that his wife was screaming and yelling, taking prescription drugs, throwing things about, threatening to break out his windows. Vanderson did have that information when he arrived an hour later. Again, akin to a call that Mr. LeFay placed, this time alleging that his wife was now attacking him. Mr. LeFay is a disabled elderly man, as is Ms. LeFay. She's an elderly female who exhibits the symptoms of having a disability. But Officer Vanderson knew that Ms. LeFay admitted that she was suffering from mental depression. Upon him questioning her and her medical history, she became easily agitated and angry. He knew that she admitted, just as the court noted, that she hadn't eaten in days. She had every opportunity to say, oh, but I've been snacking. But she never said that. She never told him that. She never denied jumping on her husband. When specifically asked, she was more concerned about this purse that her husband continuously is stealing from her. That was what Officer Vanderson was specifically asked in his deposition with respect to the delusion. Did you think that her thinking that her husband stole her purse made her delusional? No, Vanderson said no. That wasn't what he thought made her delusional. The delusion is her thinking that her husband's trying to poison her. That was the fact that Vanderson acknowledged was delusional. He also, based on his training and experience, evaluated her and determined that she was malnourished and dehydrated. This, I think, was later corroborated in her 70-minute recorded interview where she said she tried to spit on her husband, but she couldn't because she didn't have any spit. That coincides with a person who's dehydrated. To Officer Vanderson, she also...
So I tried to determine if one could properly say that the police officer had probable cause, and I looked at what is generally used for 5150 holes. There's an attempt to commit suicide or a threat to commit the suicide in bias. Poulter talks about killing him. The guy talked about killing himself if the wife divorced him. He had access to a gun and pain medication. In Heater, the plaintiff was intoxicated, had to be restrained, and said he would kill himself. And in the other case, it was where an individual's behavior was extremely dangerous, erratic. Seemed like this case really met any of those. So I was having a tough time really with whether there was probable cause.
Well, 5150 requires that Officer Vanderson observe behavioral symptoms, not necessarily make a medical diagnosis. And what he observed was that she was a danger to her husband, who he indicated had a back disability. She jumped on him and was attacking him. So she was a danger to him. In addition, based on his observations of her having to hold on to furniture as she was walking, claimed to have fibromyalgia and pain all over, the fact that she was so weak and had a body odor that even the paramedic said was so bad you wanted to put gloves on, this created a concern for him that perhaps she was gravely disabled as well. So the danger to her husband and the grave disability as a result of her mental depression is what meets the criteria of 5150.
Given Merriman versus Walton, an officer may not have probable cause if a reasonable officer would have made further inquiry before effecting the warrantless detention. Shouldn't this officer have investigated more? He only spent 3 minutes with her.
The 3 minutes is an argument from the appellants.
I understand what it is, okay. But it comes from the clock.
Right, and our officers are put in situations, especially on a night in that beat, where they have to make split-second decisions. In this instance, based on his experience, he was able to evaluate her rather quickly, and I believe his testimony was he spent 60% with husband, 40% with wife. I don't believe he ever said 3 minutes, but that's subject to check. How much time do you need to evaluate someone who's not being cooperative, who isn't able to give a concise, clear, short statement to the questions that were posed to her? He also corroborated that with her husband, who, at least to Vanderson, appeared very genuinely concerned about his wife. He didn't want her arrested for attacking him. He wanted her to get medically cleared and get help. Whether that was a ploy, whether he was acting, whether that was fake, how would Officer Vanderson know?
If we were to determine that there is no probable cause here, in other words, the district court was too quick on its call that there was probable cause, so now we're really looking at qualified immunity. The district court really didn't get to qualified immunity. Should we send this back to the district court to determine qualified immunity?
I believe, Your 70-minute interview after the fact corroborated everything he said. In fact, she provided more probable cause in that interview. She said she hadn't eaten in 3 days because there was no food in the house because she was too sore to go to the store. That her house was a filthy, filthy, filthy pig pen because she was no longer able to keep up with her home. And as far as the bruise is concerned, Officer Vanderson declares on a penalty perjury. She never showed him a bruise. Whether she showed the officers who came an hour before, possibly. Whether she showed the paramedics, possibly. But what she did say is she suffers from brain fog, which causes her to be really confused sometimes. And perhaps she's just mistaken about that. That may be a disputed fact, but it's not genuinely disputed. Vanderson never saw the bruises. Had he saw the bruises, with his paramedic experience, being a police officer, he definitely would have investigated further. Based on what he saw that night, he was convinced that Ms. LeFay needed medical help. And that's why he made the determination, and therefore, summary judgment should be affirmed as to Officer Vanderson. The city also has an appeal in this case with respect to the court's November. Before I even go there, with respect to the city of Fresno, there's been no evidence to show that there's any unlawful policy, practice, or procedure as to the city of Fresno. And if Officer Vanderson hasn't committed any constitutional violation, then there really is no claim against the city of Fresno.
But it really seems from the record that what the plaintiff wants is that if it goes back to court, they want their Monell claim revived. That's what it seems like they really want. I don't know that they're appealing the Monell ruling here necessarily. They may even have waived it. But all they're suggesting is, if I win here, I want to be able to pursue my Monell claim when I go back to court.
I believe the briefing specifically pointed to two interrogatories that the city responded to. And what the appellants were arguing is that because...
I understand your argument, but I want you to think about it. If you look at the statement of the case in the opening brief, you look at the footnote, you look at what the district court said about the Monell claim, and finally in the reply brief, it's all about defending the Monell claim at trial. I'm not sure it's in front of us.
Okay. I understand, Your Honor.
Would this be a matter for the district court to sort out a remand? If there is a remand, and where's the Monell claim? It's a matter of
that may very well be true, Your Honor. I just didn't want to waive my opportunity to argue that issue here, but I can move on. With respect to the city's appeal, it's as to...
Attorney's fees is what you're talking about.
Correct, correct. The attorney's fees ordered in the November 18, 2014 order. That was an order after the city filed the motion to modify the scheduling order to allow for the late exchange of expert reports. In that motion, the city was a prevailing party. And in that order, the court found that there was no bad faith on part of the city, there was no gamesmanship, there was no willful failure, and in fact, the court...
Any of those things, I mean, it sounded to me like, well, the city said, is, look, city caused this cost to be borne by the plaintiff, so if you want, you know, we'll give you the relief you seek, but you pay the extra money that you're extra cost you're imposing on the other side. Seems the kind of thing that district judges do all the time, and it's just instead of denying the relief, which would have been harsh, say, okay, we'll grant you the relief, but this is now imposing additional costs on the side. You get the relief you want, but you have to pay the fine. How can you possibly challenge that?
Well, for the fact that, again, the court also acknowledged that part of that delay that gave rise to the city's need to file that motion was due to the appellant's failure to provide discovery.
That's what the judge looked at the situation and, looking at all of the considerations, decided that, you are the one who caused the problem. Instead of denying you the relief that you seek, you get the relief, but you have to pay the fine. It's not a determination that you're bad people or there was bad faith or anything else. It was just simply splitting of the baby.
Right.
And I would think that you guys would be grateful
here's why. The city proposed a less drastic sanction, and the court agreed and said in this hearing that the city would be limited in its expert, would have to use this preliminary rough draft dirty report, and that's what he's limited to. In addition, he is not allowed to comment upon opposing counsel's expert. Fine, and that was all discussed during the hearing. We argued that. At no time during that hearing did the appellants even request attorney's fees. I was not, that was never a subject of that underlying hearing.
I just want to confirm, as I understand it, when we were having this conference, the court invited the parties to submit formal motions about the discovery dispute, right? And you're the only one that brought the motion.
With respect to the motion to modify the scheduling order?
Or even with respect to anything to do with the discovery dispute. The plaintiff brought to the court's attention your failure to comply with the discovery dispute conference, but the court said at that point, hey, this is just in a general conference. If you want to do something about that, file a motion. At that point, you filed a motion to extend the deadline. The plaintiff didn't file any motion whatsoever.
Correct.
Not for fees, not for anything.
Correct. Not until after the court gave him unilaterally the opportunity to file a motion for fees. Correct. Thank you, Your Honors.
You are way over your time.
Must correct some serious misstatements on the record. No one at the hospital confirmed the 5150 determination. The record is very clear.
They did release it, right?
Well, doctor, that's...
They sent them on to the next step. They could have released them.
Yeah, well, they could have. The only person qualified at St. Agnes where she first went was the social worker who instead decided it was better not to wake her up. The first time that she was medically assessed, that she received the 5152 screening.
But the social worker works with the doctor, gets information from the doctor. She was examined by a doctor. There was a social worker involved who, after some time, the doctor decides it's best to let them. There's no mistake. I mean, it's perfectly clear what the opposing counsel said.
The doctor himself admitted he was not qualified. Not every physician, not every MD is qualified to make a decision on a 5150. You have to have a certain certification for mental health training, which the ER physician did not have. The only one who had the authority to either release or impose or continue the 5150 at the hospital was the social worker. And she did not.
Doctor's not qualified to talk to the social worker and give the social worker his assessment of her condition. He's not qualified to do that.
There's no indication in the record that that ever occurred.
I'm sorry, did you hear my question?
I'm sorry?
Did you hear my question?
Yes, there's no indication in the record that...
Did you hear my question?
I did, but I might have misunderstood. The
doctor is not qualified to tell the social worker his assessment of her condition.
He's qualified to say that, but there's no indication in this instance that it would occur.
So what? I mean, why does there have to be an indication on that?
Well, how do we know it happened if there's no evidence?
How do we know it didn't happen?
Because doctor...
I mean, you can claim here, so you know, she acted on her own, but we don't know. You didn't ask the question.
With respect to... The evidence shows that the first time that Mrs. Fayer was screened, she was released. And this is something that shows the district court's error. It relied on, it made an assumption that was not supported by the record that this hold was somehow confirmed down the line. First of all, probable cause is based on what the officer knew, not what happens at the hospital. And second, that's the same problem with this 70-minute interview that was referred to. That occurred months later. That shouldn't be considered either in determining